So keeping my eyes on it, I walked around to the side of my house so that this object was between my house and slightly over my neighbor's house as well, probably about 300-400 feet in the air. The object, as I studied it, appeared to be about 4 to 6 foot in diameter. And I watched it for a couple of minutes. I heard no sounds. I could see the object floating almost as if it was in water. It would rise up and down just slightly and sway back and forth a little bit. And it had what appeared to be something coming down from the bottom. I thought perhaps it was a balloon. And then the more I looked at it, the more I could see faintly some windows or a stripe going around the center of this sphere. And I decided, well, it hadn't gone away after 2 or 3 minutes, so I thought I'd take a chance, run inside, grab my camera, a Nikon, came out, set it up on a tripod, and started taking photographs of it.
That was Rick Ibarra. On September 10th, 2014, Rick pulled into his driveway around 6:45 p.m. when he noticed a sphere in the sky. A retired Department of Defense therapist who worked at Naval Base San Diego and Submarine Base Point Loma, we recently spoke to him about the sighting.
So keeping my eyes on it, I walked around to the side of my house so that this object was between my house and slightly over my neighbor's house as well, probably about 300-400 feet in the air. The object, as I studied it, appeared to be about 4 to 6 foot in diameter. And I watched it for a couple of minutes, anticipating that it would fly away or do something different.
Rick next grabbed his camera and tripod and snapped these. The metadata matches his account, showing the images were taken over a half-hour period during twilight. ISO settings and exposure times go up accordingly. Illumination on the right side of the object also matches Rick's statement that he was facing south. Light from post-sunset appears reflective off the object's metallic surface. We asked about the possibility this was influenced by the wind.
While I was watching this, the wind was minimal. I would say we had a breeze of probably about 5 miles an hour. It was coming off the west because that's in San Diego. In the late afternoons and evenings, the coastal winds come off the ocean and blow inland, and it keeps things cool here. So the light breeze that was coming through was just enough to rustle the leaves on the tree, but not much else. As the object in the air was floating, it drifted south. So it was, I would say, not really blowing, or rather, it wasn't really moving against the wind. But it wasn't moving with the wind either, and it didn't seem to be, wind wasn't really anything that was in play the way the object was moving.
We also asked about the possibility this was a balloon on a tether.
So as I was looking at this, I noticed what appeared to be some kind of a line or tether coming down from the bottom. And as I looked at the video footage and blew up one of the, or enlarged one of the photos that I took, I noticed that there were actually three antenna coming from it, one left, one right, one on the bottom. And the antenna extended approximately 2 feet, I think 2 feet in either direction, the left, right, and the bottom, nothing that I could see on the top. And the surface of the object appeared to be metallic. The antenna appeared to be independently moving because I think if they were blowing with the wind, they would have been blowing or moving in the same direction. But these antenna were moving in different directions, almost as if they were arms that were waving. And the one on the bottom wasn't really moving much at all. The ones on the left and the right were the ones that were moving the most, kind of independently of each other.
He took 12 minutes of video on digital tape, ending the footage when the object had moved too far away to record in low light or see with the naked eye.
Camera's not able to focus on it.
He told us something else.
afterwards, I noticed that my neighbor was outside playing with his children. And so the next day I went over and asked him if he noticed anything. And he told me that he did look up in the sky. He noticed something, but he didn't pay much attention to it. Continued playing with his kids. Since then, I've asked him a couple of times about this object, and he has a vague recollection, but he has no real details and didn't find anything of interest to really talk about.
We're keeping his address private for obvious reasons, but he did share information about nearby air traffic. A local civilian airport is 5 miles away, and the Marine Corps Air Station at Miramar is 10 miles away. Important to mention, he does have a military background. For 10 years, he says he worked at 2 area Navy bases as a marriage and family therapist, employed by the Department of Defense. And the next 18 years in a similar role with the Marine Corps Recruit Depot near San Diego International Airport. To the best of our ability, we verified what we could about his educational background. Military therapist records are not public, nor are they digitized. Rick told us he shared the video of the sphere with his chain of command. They were, quote, awestruck by the footage and didn't offer any explanation at all. Unfortunately, some quality loss occurred when the footage was transferred from the 720 resolution video camera. And the video is all most people know about this case, which is why we wanted to add the photos and witness testimony to public record. If this is a genuine unidentified aerial phenomenon, it is one of the best documented outside official military channels. GATR Technologies, a subsidiary of San Diego-based Cubic Corps, does manufacture inflatable satellite antenna spheres. They have contracts with the U.S. Army and Special Operations Command. But they are not metallic and not airborne, nor are they capable of flight. We also found an uncanny resemblance to a sighting decades earlier. August 1968. Brazilian Air Force files show a merchant in Sao Paulo witnessed a metallic globe with rainbow-like streaks. It is surrounded by a ridge with 2 antennae, moving laterally in the sky until it disappeared. A year later, a similar-looking object with a bigger central mass appeared above a football field. The antennae were lit up, witnesses said. In 1973, U.S. Navy men saw this object in northwest Australia. Similar features, minus the antennae. Speaking to us, Rick mentioned something else, a possible second sighting.
A few days later, probably close to about 4 or 5 days later, I was getting ready to go to work. And this was about 5 o'clock in the morning. And I was getting ready and I was in my bedroom and I felt an urge to go outside. Now, I never go outside. I have a deck outside my bedroom. And I felt an urge to go outside. When I went outside, off in the distance, I saw this object. And it could have been a bird, but at the same time, it flew straight across the sky horizontally from east to west. And it was only in my vision for probably 5 seconds. And it moved very fast, but at the same time, it looked spherical.
Before this episode, we gauged viewer opinions on the San Diego sphere. Many believed it deserved to be ruled unidentified, but a few thought it was a balloon. It's interesting that as Rick analyzed the object, he slowly went away from any terrestrial hypothesis because of 4 things. Stop-start movement, failure to move with the wind, metallic appearance, seemingly independent moving antenna-like appendages. We've read hundreds of Project Blue Book case files by now. Taking a page from their method of analyzing witnesses, Rick is a credible observer for 2 reasons: his background and lack of desire to promote this. He reported it to MUFON, New Fork, and uploaded the video to YouTube, and he was done. Nowhere has he tried to monetize his experience or even share all of his photos. We had to seek him out and felt his story deserved exposure after his video was being shared online with no context. What do you think? Is this one of the best modern UFO cases? Does the San Diego sphere deserve to be called unidentified? Or not? Let us know your opinion in the comments. And special thanks to our patrons, including Plunk Skills. There's more to do with this sighting, including cross-referencing all unmanned aircraft reports from nearby airports. We're going to do more of this, so if you like it, consider joining us on Patreon and help us produce one new episode every single week. Most of our traffic comes from external shares, so if you have any family or friends interested, we'd appreciate it if you ask them to subscribe. Thanks again. See you next time.